My fellow libertarians, I wish to thank you for having done me the honour of inviting you to address your international conference. And I'm speaking to you from my home in Kent, in England, by a miracle of technology, or what would even 5-10 years ago have been regarded as a miracle. Now, we do live in an age of technical miracles. Things are possible today of which we could barely dream 10, even 5 years ago. In some degree, we are living in the science fiction future that was imagined in the 1930s, 40s, 50s and 60s. However, I am not addressing you today to jolly you along, to tell you that we are winning, that history is moving in a libertarian direction. I do accept that if you are from Russia or one of the Central or Eastern European liberated states, things may appear rather different. Of course, the past 20 years have seen a steady, indeed a dramatic improvement in your life chances, in your chances of living a reasonably free life. But let me speak to you from the perspective of an Englishman, or perhaps an American, or certainly somebody from within the English-speaking world. I have been a member of the libertarian movement now for over 30 years. I drifted into the movement in 1979. And back then, there were people telling me, "Sean, history is moving with us. Sean, we are moving steadily towards a more libertarian society." The great deviation that took place during the 20th century is coming to an end. The 21st century will be better than the 20th. Again, in some respects, it has been better than the 20th century. We have not so far managed to blunder into a gigantic war. But again, let me look at this from the perspective of someone from the English-speaking world. 30 years ago, I lived in what could be described as a broken-down liberal democracy. Yes, the government had laws that tried to control the price of bread. Yes, the trade unions had all manner of privileges which were an affront to reason and to the common law. Yes, taxes were rather high. Yes, regulations were rather high. Yes, yes, yes. But 30 years ago, a man could walk into a lawyer's office in England, put down £50,000 in cash on a table, and buy a property. And the lawyer might grumble at having to count all this money and then take it off to the bank. But that was a perfectly valid, legitimate transaction. Nowadays, in any of our countries nowadays, you cannot really use more than £10,000, €10,000, $15,000 in cash without being reported to the authorities and without being taken aside by your own bank or financial advisor or the person with whom you're doing business and being asked, "Why are you dealing in cash? Where did you get this? Are you some kind of drug dealer? Are you a terrorist? What are you doing? Explain yourself." This is an affront to liberty. And it's not an affront to liberty in the sense that many other laws are. This is a fundamental violation of our right to any degree of privacy and to dignity. 30 years ago, you could walk into a restaurant, you could walk into a cinema, you could walk onto a railway train and light up a cigarette. Now, of course, if you are not a smoker, this is not something that will have you lying awake at night thinking how unfree we've become. But the war against smoking is a very significant extension of the war against drugs. The war against drugs, an outrage, absolute outrage. But it was an outrage that affected relatively few people. Extending this to the war against smoking is an extension of this war to cover something like a third, maybe half, of the population. 30 years ago, children at school were not indoctrinated about the need to save the planet from some fictitious threat of man-made global warming. Nowadays, it is very similar in England and in Western Europe and in America to the kind of wall-to-wall school propaganda that was the normal course of things in a totalitarian country. I do not believe that the overall burden of taxes has come down during the past 30 years, that the burden of taxes has steadily increased. It is, I accept, very hard to measure this because we need to define what is a tax, whether a regulation, whether a privilege to some special interest group counts as a tax on ordinary people. But certainly, I do not think taxes have come down. I do believe that taxes have steadily increased. What I'm saying is that the world of 2011 is significantly and obviously less free than the world of 1981, a world which I do not recall believing at the time was itself particularly free. And so why are we still bothering? Why bother with this conference? Why does the Libertarian Alliance continue to publish? Why so much media outreach? Why do I go on the television every week? Why do I go on the radio two or three times a week? Why do I go to conferences? Why am I speaking to you? Well, there are two answers to that. The first is that this is a kind of hobby. There are some people who spend their lives collecting matchbox labels or looking at railway trains and writing down the numbers. And then there are some people who get involved in political movements and spend their lives busy in projects which may never amount to anything at all. I'm so old now that if you took away libertarian activism, I really wouldn't know what to do with my spare moments. But there is another reason why we should carry on. Just like a defeated army marching away from a battle, you have to keep in formation, you have to keep marching forward. You don't know what you're marching towards, but if you scatter and run all over the countryside, that really is the end of things. Now, I do not believe there is any significant chance that any of us will win a general election and form a libertarian government in our country. I do not believe that any of us will have a significant long-term impact on the policy of our governments. I don't believe it. Murray Rothbard once said, "Why is it that none of our friends ever get into positions of political importance?" And his answer was, because when they do get into positions of political importance, they stop being our friends. There is no salvation, I think, through the ordinary political process. But there is hope. And I think the most important hope is this. The current order of things within which we live may look solid. It may look as if it can go on forever and ever and ever without changing. But all systems that are fundamentally at war with human nature look like this. Who would have thought in 1988 the Soviet Union would implode and its entire empire would just fall away? Who would have thought in 1788 that the French monarchy of the Ancien Regime would disappear within 4 years? Who would have thought in 1912, let's say, that the Russian despotism would collapse? All of these systems look solid, right up until the moment when they crumble. And although our present system is less immediately and obviously oppressive than the French and the Tsarist and the Soviet despotisms. It is, I think, in many respects, more at war with reality. Our entire system proceeds by denying certain basic facts. Oh, if you look at the nonsense about the environment, you can see that vast swathes of government activity are based on a patently false belief about the effect of human activity on the environment. I do not regard myself as a monetary economist, but of course I have taught economics, I do know a fair bit about economics, and you don't need to be much of an economic genius to know that something funny is going on with the money in our countries. This cannot continue. Sooner or later, it may be next week, it may be next year, it may be in 20 years' time, you never can tell before these things happen, but sooner or later the current order of things will break down and will pass away and will be replaced by something else. And that is where our opportunity will be provided. I do not believe that if the British political system were to break down on Monday, anybody would come knocking on my door saying, "Sean, we would like you to be Lord Protector of England, and we will do whatever you want." No, that is not going to happen. But I will tell you something. When one particular legitimation of state activity breaks down, the politicians go looking for another. Politicians ultimately have no principles, that their only motivation is power. That doesn't mean that they're necessarily bad people, it's just that their motivation is power. They're office maximizers. Now, if one particular legitimation of power breaks down, they will go looking for another. And if we have all stopped thinking and arguing and publishing, and if we have allowed the international libertarian movement to disintegrate, then we shall not be in the running for when those politicians come looking for a new legitimization. Again, I am not saying that if we continue to run these conferences, if we continue to publish, if we continue to appear in the media, that the next legitimation of power will be libertarian. But I do say this, if we are there as a significant intellectual force, then when the present order of things passes away and the politicians come looking for some other body of ideas, there is a chance, may not be a huge chance, but there is a chance that some of the things that we are saying will be accepted, will be taken up, and there is some chance that we shall be able to contribute, however partially, however imperfectly, to a better state of affairs than we currently enjoy. And so, I won't say that history is on our side, I won't say that the world is moving in our direction, and that you can see this in the various laws that are being made in Britain, America, or continental Europe, or wherever. I see no reason to suppose this whatever. But I do say that our duty is, like a defeated army, to keep walking forward, one foot in front of the other, because the really important battle is still to be fought, and there is still a chance that we shall be able to contribute to the victory of right, truth, and justice. Again, many thanks for having invited me to address you, even if at some distance, and I do hope that you enjoy the conference. Thank you.